Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for bearing with us as we just get the technical aspects taken care of here. My name is Youssef Munayer. I'm the director of the Jerusalem Fund here, and I'm happy to welcome you to this Palestine Center program today. We're very happy to host, and of course, this program is co-hosted by the Institute for Palestine Studies, and we're very happy to be able to bring this event here together on Palestinians in Latin America, which I've always found to be a fascinating and under-discussed subject. So I think we're really in for a treat today with this talk. I would just ask that you silence any cell phones that you have so we can give our undivided attention to our speaker today. And also for those watching the live stream through the internet, we encourage you to participate in the conversation in the question and answer session by sending in your questions via Twitter. You could do that by sending them to @PalestineCenter. We will do our best to relay them to our speaker today and get an answer for all of you watching out there on the World Wide Web. At this point, I want to ask Michelle from IPS to introduce you to our speaker today.
Hi, my name is Michelle Esposito. I'm the Executive Director of the Institute for Palestine Studies, and it's my pleasure to be here today co-hosting with the Jerusalem Fund this one of our prospective authors, Dr. Cecilia Baeza, as part of the Institute's 50th anniversary celebrations. A key mission of the Institute is to encourage and foster promising young academics who are opening new inroads in the study of Palestinian affairs and the Arab-Israeli conflict. Dr. Baeza certainly fits the bill as an up-and-coming scholar to watch. Dr. Baeza is a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute of International Relations at the University of Brasilia. Between 2003 and 2009, she was associate professor at Sciences Po Paris, where she concluded her PhD in political science in 2010. Her dissertation focused on Palestinian immigrants and their descendants in Chile, Honduras, and Brazil, and their relation with the Palestinian nationalism. She now works on the redefinition over the past decade of South American foreign policies towards the Palestinian issue. She also analyzes the role of the Arab diasporas through their mobilization and networks of influence. In addition, Dr. Baeza is co-founder of RIMAL, a research network on Latin America and the Arab world. She's currently preparing a book on the Palestinian diaspora in Latin America based on her dissertation. Please join me in thanking the Jerusalem Fund for co-sponsoring our talk today, and please welcome Dr. Baeza.
So first of all, I'd like to thank the Institute of Palestine Studies and the Jerusalem Fund for this kind invitation. It's really a pleasure for me to be here and to present part of my research. Latin America hosts the largest Palestinian presence outside the Arab world. Immigration began at the end of the 19th century and reached its peak between 1900 and 1930. Immigration waves have then continued following the episodes of war and economic crisis in Palestine, but they never reached the magnitude of the first decades of the 20th century. Latin American of Palestinian descent claim today to be more than 500,000, but little to nothing has been written about them and their relation with Palestine. Sons of a pre-Nakba immigration, for the most, predominantly Christians, middle to upper class citizens, well represented among political and business elites, Palestinians in Latin America do not easily fit in a national narrative shaped by the refugee experience. In fact, Palestinian historiography has long seemed uninterested by this diaspora who doesn't meet the criteria of Palestinianness as defined by the political necessities of a nationalist discourse centered on the state of dispossession, denial, and statelessness of the refugees. This lack of interest also had to do with the scale of analysis. At a national level, immigration to Latin America only represented a small phenomenon in Palestine. We therefore have to adopt a finer scale of analysis to reveal its importance both at the local and transnational level. My talk today will present first the socio-economic trajectories of these immigrants and their descendants according to periods and countries. As I will show, their modes of incorporation and socio-economic status are fundamental for understanding the position of individuals regarding the Palestinian cause. I will then explore the journey of their identity over generations and its articulation with long-distance nationalism. I will finish this talk by discussing the shifting notion of Palestinian diaspora and its relation to homeland and return. My presentation focuses on Chile and Honduras. Those two countries host the largest populations of Palestinian descent. In Chile, diaspora organizations claim they represent at least 350,000 people. And in Honduras, historians talk about 280,000 Hondurans of Palestinian descent. So for the coherence of my argument, I will leave aside the Palestinian communities of Brazil and Venezuela, mostly Muslim and post-Nakba, but I will be pleased to answer questions after the presentation. I will divide this talk in two parties, and each one in three periods. From 1880 to 1948, from 1948 to 1970, and from 1970 until today. Arab immigration from Palestine to Latin America started in the late Ottoman period, around 1870. The majority were Christians and came from the region of Bethlehem, including the villages of Beit Jala and Beit Sahur, and to a lesser extent from Jerusalem, Taibe, and Ramallah. Why Christians and why from these regions in particular? Because with the development of a new modern European tourism in the Holy Land at the end of the 19th century, the production of religious handcraft increased and a new class of Christian merchants emerged, in particular in Bethlehem. Some of them early sought to expand their activities to Europe, especially in France, but rapidly, America became the new El Dorado. It's important to remind that this happened in the context of the great immigration waves to the New World. Just to have an idea of the figures, we are talking about almost 60 million Europeans and 1.2 million Ottoman citizens coming to the Americas between 1860 and 1914. Palestinian immigration was part of this movement, even though it only accounted for a very small portion of these waves. It seems that one of the first reasons to cross the Atlantic was to attend international fairs in the US. For example, the Palestinian historian from Bethlehem, Adnan Musallam, has documented the participation of Palestinian merchants in the International Exhibition of 1866 in Philadelphia, the Chicago World's Fair in 1893, and the Universal Exposition of St. Louis in 1904. Some of these merchants pursued their trip to the south and arrived to Mexico and Central America, mainly Honduras and El Salvador. Another route led them directly to Buenos Aires, Argentina. All across Latin America, Palestinians arriving with an Ottoman passport were labeled by immigration officers as Turcos, independently from their self-identification. Turcos was then a large administrative and social category, including all the Arab immigrants from Bilad el-Sham, but also Armenians, Jews of Aleppo, and Greeks. In all countries, Palestinian merchants started peddling goods from door to door. Their first goods were religious handcraft, but then they expanded to other manufactured products. To avoid competition with other Arab immigrants, mostly Syrians and Lebanese, who were more numerous and therefore had stronger solidarity networks, Palestinians rapidly left Buenos Aires and Sao Paulo and crossed the Cordillera to establish their business in smaller countries, further from the major Atlantic ports. That's how Palestinian merchants arrived in Chile circa 1880 and to a lesser extent in Peru, Bolivia, and Ecuador. This implicit strategy of non-competition between Arab solidarity networks explain why Syrian and Lebanese make the majority of the Arab diaspora in Brazil, Argentina, Mexico, and Venezuela, the largest countries of Latin America, while Palestinians are the majority in Chile, Peru, Honduras, and El Salvador. A common feature of all the Arab immigrants in Latin America is that they became middleman minorities, a concept coined to describe those groups whose ethnicity is intertwined with the activity of trade and commerce. Turco literally became a synonym of peddler. Indeed, until the first decades of the 20th century, retail was terribly underdeveloped in Latin America. The elites were latifundistas and compradors, but not retailers. The status gap between elites and masses was such that a direct contact between them was just unthinkable. Turcos suffered from ethnic discrimination. Unlike the European immigrants, they had not been called by Latin American state to occupy and farm the vast portion of cultivable land. Arabs and Jews were particularly unwelcomed by the criollas elites, who had in mind the stereotypes imported from the European racialist ideologies. For the rest of the population, however, it was not clear whether the Arab immigrants were white or not, and the pejorative connotation of Turco was more associated with their office as retailers and their cultural manners than to their alleged racial belonging. Peddling was then a hard but a lucrative job. The majority was able, after a few years, to open their own shops. Merchants had long hours of work and very little time or money spent on consumption. The emphasis was put on saving, and the idea was to come back to their hometowns with the accumulated wealth. In fact, there are several success stories of immigrants who returned to Palestine with great amount of wealth. These individual stories fed the myth of the Latin American El Dorado. Palestinian emigration gained momentum until the 1920s. With the Young Turk Revolution of 1908, a new military conscription law was voted in 1909, making military service compulsory for all Ottoman subjects. Christian families were particularly afraid of seeing their sons serving as cannon fodder and decided to send their children to Latin America, where they already have some relatives. Muslim families were also keen to send their sons abroad, but they lacked the transnational contacts to do so. The economic situation in Palestine dramatically deteriorated with the First World War. Jabra, a famous writer from Bethlehem, described in his novel The First Well the poverty of his hometown and the state of abandonment of the houses left by the families who emigrated to Latin America. These marked the beginning of a chain migration. Nephews, brothers, cousins, and sometimes entire families came to join their relatives. Men were called to work in trade, following the pioneer's path, while women mostly arrived as daughters and spouses. Indeed, until 1930, more than 90% of the marriages were endogamous. Not necessarily in the sense of the Arab marriage between cousins, but at least ethnically speaking between Arabs. So we can say that Palestinian immigration was the result of a combination of pull and push factors. On the one hand, pull factors such as powerful economic opportunities for Christian merchants, and on the other, push factors such as the fear of religious and ethnic discrimination in the context of a rising Turkish nationalism. But it was also, and maybe above all, a product of chain migrations. The status of middleman minorities carried by Palestinian immigrants started to change before 1948, in the decade of the 1930s. After the Wall Street crash of 1929 and the beginning of the Great Depression, Latin American countries witnessed a change in their economic orientation. The abrupt fall of the export of commodities obliged political leaders to rethink their development strategy. The response of government was to reorient national development towards inward-looking goals through import substituting industrialization. This new economic strategy required people with capital to start this industrial adventure. Only few traditional landowners in Latin America were interested in taking these risks. But immigrant merchants also had some capital, and some of them accepted to become the new partners of Latin American developmental states. The trajectory of Juan Yarur Lolas is exemplary of this partnership. Juan Yarur and his younger brother Nicolas left Palestine in 1902. They already had relatives in Chile and in Bolivia. After a few years of peddling, the two brothers opened a shop, and in 1929, they were able to open a small textile plant in La Paz, Bolivia. In the mid-30s, the Chilean government of President Alessandri invited Juan Yarur to install a bigger plant in Santiago. The offer included free custom duties for imported machine tools, low custom taxes for imported supplies, and a loan of more than $1 million from the Banco de Chile, the largest banking institution of the country. De Yarur accepted this generous deal and founded a company of cotton. In 1948, the plant employed more than 300 workers and produced 60% of the cotton fabrics of the country. It became the biggest textile plant of Latin America. According to the registers of the Syrian-Palestinian Commercial Association, 147 industrial plants were created in Chile with Arab funds between 1933 and 1937. Two-thirds of them were in the textile and clothing industry. A similar process took place in Honduras, but with smaller projects. For example, Jacobo Catan produced and registered in 1930 the first clothing brand of Central America. In both countries, the birth of these new industries came along with the creation of private banks. New fund manufacturers needed a financial infrastructure to accompany their investments. As Latin American banking systems were embryonic, Palestinians started creating their own investment banks. In Chile, for example, Juan Yarur founded in 1937 the BCI, the Banco de Crédito e Inversiones, one of the main Chilean banks until today. This new economic phase inevitably entailed a process of settlement. In the decade of 1940, immigrants started to buy new and bigger houses. In Santiago de Chile, a Palestinian ethnic district emerged, the neighborhood of Patronato. Host of the first Orthodox church built by the Palestinian community in 1917, Patronato was characterized by the presence of small sewing workshops, clothing stores, and the residences of the first and second generation Palestinian immigrants. The Nakba clearly had an impact on Palestinian settlement. It reinforced the option of non-return, even if the window of opportunity had already begun to close during the British mandate, and I will develop this later. For now, what I would like to stress is that from the 30s to the 70s, we witnessed a process of growing social differentiation within the Palestinian community. On the one hand, the industrialists, who slowly started to break into local bourgeoisies, even though they were still discriminated against as Turcos Nouveau Riche, and on the other hand, the small retailers and manufacturers who joined the burgeoning middle classes. Importantly, most of these middle class families encouraged their children to go to the university and to study law, medicine, engineering, etc. This process has been particularly evident in Chile. The development of universities offered real opportunities for aspirational middle classes. In Honduras, as in the rest of Central America, where the quality of higher education was not as good, the preferred strategy was to keep the business and try to make it grow. The new professional middle classes of Palestinian descent began to show interest in local politics as soon as the 30s, with several Palestinians elected mayor. In Chile, the first congressman of Arab descent appeared in the 1940s, but the key decade was the 50s. Two ministers of the government of President Ibanez were for the first time of Palestinian descent. The most important was Rafael Tarud Siwadi, Minister of Economy and Mining, known as El Turco Tarud. Entering politics at a national level was not easy. Traditional institutionalized parties were not eager to integrate these sons of Levantine immigrants. The right wing was particularly reluctant. The apparition of prominent politicians of Palestinian descent was made possible only by the upsurge of non-traditional, progressive and populist parties looking for new and fresh faces. So at the beginning of the 70s, the Palestinian community was experiencing again growing divisions. A process of social differentiation between a new industrial bourgeoisie and professional and educated middle classes, and an increasing political polarization between a new generation of politicians of Palestinian descent leaning towards the left and industrialists remaining conservative. This process was definitely deeper in Chile than in other countries like Honduras, where the Palestinian community remained more socially and economically homogeneous. For Latin America, the 70s and the 80s were decades of dramatic political polarization and crisis in the context of the Cold War. In 1970, Salvador Allende, the candidate of a coalition of left-wing parties, won the presidential election in Chile with a strong reformist agenda. Workers dreamed of self-management of industry and started occupying their factories and denouncing exploitation. Under the pressure of workers' union, several plants were expropriated by the government. Textile factories were on the front line of the movement. The seizure of the Yarur factory on April 1971 marked the beginning of a tumultuous process. Then came the nationalization of the textile plants of the Sumar, the Said, and the Hirmas families. There are several reasons for this. The textile sector was one of the most labor-intensive industries, and its workers were among the most unionized. The other reason is less noble. Part of the traditional Chilean bourgeoisie didn't do anything to save the sector. Actually, some were secretly quite satisfied to see these Turcos losing the wealth they had acquired so quickly. But in spite of these rivalries among the upper class, you will not be surprised to hear that the industrialists of Palestinian descent were harsh opponents of the government of Salvador Allende. In fact, some of them played a crucial role in the military coup against the democratic government in September 1973. Juan and Alberto Casis Sabag, for example, two brothers born in Bethlehem, received the dissident generals at their homes a few days before the coup. This is not a secret. Alberto Casis is also one of the founders of the Pinochet Foundation. However, we can also find individuals of Palestinian descent who supported the government of Allende and were condemned to exile after the coup. The film director Miguel Littin, the poet and ambassador Mahfoud Massis, and the former minister Rafael Tarud, just to name a few. The military government of Augusto Pinochet rapidly gave the textile factories back to their owners. But the paradox is that the neoliberal turn of the regime brought the textile industry to its knees. Faced by international competition in 1975, production had fallen by 31% and several enterprises went bankrupt. Ironically, this was the result of the policies of the Minister of Economy, Jorge Caguas Lama, himself of Palestinian descent. The majority of these industrialists recovered from this radical economic change. They diversified their investment and expanded to new sectors, in particular real estate, media, and retail. The best example is probably José Said Safie, whose family began in the textile industry, but is today the main shareholder of the Said Group, a holding which possesses the third largest Chilean shopping malls company. Others focused on their banking activities, like the Yarur and the BCI, the Abu Mohor and Coop Banca, or the Rishmawe with the Union Credit Bank. In Honduras, Honduran Palestinian industrialists also experienced an evolution of their activities, but it was less dramatic than in Chile. During the 80s, the country evaded the violence that affected its neighboring countries, Nicaragua, El Salvador, and Guatemala. In fact, Honduras even served as a base for US-sponsored Contras in their war against Sandinists in Nicaragua. The hegemonic ideological climate of anti-communism and the weakness of the pro-guerrilla movement in Palestine, in Honduras, prevented the emergence of left-wing Palestinian leaders, similar to Shafiq Handal, for example, the historical leader of the Salvadoran guerrilla, or Moises Hassan, one of the prominent figures of the Nicaraguan guerrilla in the 80s. On the opposite, Palestinian industrialists in Honduras strongly supported the anti-subversion policy implemented in Honduras during this period. Miguel Facuse, currently the richest man in Honduras, was the spearhead of this movement. At the end of the 80s, the Honduran government decided to expand the free trade zones onto the Caribbean coast, allowing the development of maquilas, that is, factories manufacturing products on a duty-free basis for exports. Palestinians were pioneers of the maquila sector. Anti-communism is still virulent today among these businessmen, who strongly supported the destitution of President Zelaya in 2009. In a context of political tension and violence in the country, these stance favored the emergence of anti-Turco and anti-Palestinian feelings in Honduras. Palestinians are perceived by some sectors of the working class as the powerful owners of the country. Such kinds of feelings would be impossible in Chile. The positions of Chilean Palestinians are too diverse to be associated with one social class. It does not mean that in Honduras all the people of Palestinian origin are wealthy, of course not, but the concentration of capital makes the exposure of the industrialists much greater. So, after having described these socio-economic trajectories, I would like now to look back on these three periods and explore the evolution of the identification of the Palestinians in Latin America over the generation. So let's start with the end of the 19th century until 1948. This period is crucial because it constitutes a key testimony of the modes of identification of the inhabitants of Palestine before 1948. How did self-define these immigrants from Palestine? If we cannot interview the oldest immigrants who arrived at the end of the 19th century, we still have several evidences of their self-identification. Some notes on the immigration registers, the name of their associations, and the ethnic press, which began to develop in the decade of the 1910s. Until 1920, immigrants from Palestine used to mention alternatively four focuses of identity: their hometown, in this case Bethlehem, Bejala, and Betzahor; Syria, in the sense of Bilad el-Sham; their religion, here mainly Orthodox Christianity and the consciousness of coming from the Holy Land; and finally, their Arabness. References to Palestine were rare, but they did exist. By contrast, the identification with the Ottoman Empire was almost inexistent. This started to change from the 20s. In 1920, the Club Deportivo Palestino, a professional football club, was founded in Santiago de Chile. The name of the club, Palestino, and the colors of the football jersey, those of the Palestinian flag, were clearly a nationalist reference. This new identification gained momentum from 1924. Between 1924 and 1939, dozens of organizations with a direct and unique reference to Palestine were founded all across Latin America. how to explain the emergence of this new Palestinian consciousness. The establishment of the British Mandate over Palestine terribly complicated the life of immigrants, and these new difficulties certainly made them more aware of the political precariousness of their homeland. The main obstacle faced by the immigrants was the issue of return, temporary or definitive. Indeed, until the 30s, immigrants used to move back and forth between their host countries and Palestine. Immigrants came back, lived a few years in Palestine, and left again their homeland to Latin America. This pattern was quite common. During the Ottoman era, immigrants who had kept their Ottoman nationality could legally return to Palestine. However, and this is a paradox, the issuing of a Palestinian nationality by British authorities in 1925 changed this situation. Immigrants had then or to ask for a visa, in case they had acquired the nationality of their host countries, or as Palestinian-born, ask for the Palestinian nationality itself. Therein lies the crux of the problem. The condition for obtaining the Palestinian nationality as defined by the Treaty of Lausanne were extremely hard to meet for the immigrants. The application of the treaty created hardships for thousands of Palestine natives who were resident abroad. Let's take the case of Issa Nasser, for example. Born in Bethlehem, he emigrated in 1913 as a merchant to Chile with an Ottoman passport, which expired with the Treaty of Lausanne. As he did not have the Palestinian nationality, he needed an emergency certificate issued by the British consulate in Valparaiso to be able to travel to Palestine. The temporary document clearly specified that he did not guarantee that the holder would be authorized to land or remain in Palestine. But going to Palestine was not the only problem. In some cases, such as Chile and Mexico, the inability to provide a valid nationality prevented from renewing the residence permit, or worse, the access to naturalization. This situation led thousands of immigrants to become stateless. In some countries, like in El Salvador, the absence of nationality prohibited the exercise of trade, jeopardizing the main source of income from Palestinian immigrants. Facing these difficulties, immigrants decided to organize themselves to make them heard. Dozens of complaints were made by immigrants from the British consulates of Latin America and remained deposited in the archives of the Leagues of Nations. Immigrants argued that they still had land in Palestine, and despite the fact that they were currently involved in trade activities in their host countries, they still planned to return home in the near future. In Palestine, immigrants received the support of young nationalists, including Aysel Bandak from Bethlehem, who launched in 1927 the Committee for the Defense of Immigrants' Rights to Palestinian Citizenship. The committee collected the grievances of immigrants and presented them to the British High Commissioner for Palestine. British authority lightly relaxed the condition for obtaining the nationality, but it did not make a big difference. Following the outbreak of the Great Arab Revolt, Aysel Bandak renewed the petition in 1936 to the Peel Commission without any significant result. As a consequence, only a very limited number of immigrants were able to get Palestinian nationality. In 1946, it was documented that only 465 persons of those who were born in Palestine and were residing abroad could acquire Palestinian nationality. It did not mean that it was impossible for immigrants to come back, but it certainly dissuaded more than one. The temporary situation of statelessness of some immigrants made Montaz Kafiche, professor of international law at the Hebron University, speak about the first generation of Palestinian refugees. I understand the interest of such a provocative stance that allows pointed out a situation that was completely neglected, but I'm not sure that it can really be used because, as we have seen, the logics of immigration cannot be reduced to the result of an expulsion. So, this Palestinian nationality eventually disappeared with the creation of the State of Israel in 1948. But for immigrants, it was clearly the first political experience of their Palestinianness. independently from the fact they succeeded to have it or not, the struggle for nationality was itself meaningful. In fact, the decade of the 30s witnessed the development of a very dynamic nationalist ethnic press in Latin America. The best examples are Al Islah, the reform in Chile, published from 1930 to 1942, and also distributed in Peru, Bolivia, and Ecuador, and Rumbos, published in Honduras from 1939. The press diffused political information from Palestine, and this clearly had an impact. For example, in 1939, Palestinians in Chile and in Honduras collected funds for the families of martyrs of the Great Arab Revolt. The result of all of this is that at the end of the 30s, we have a population who increasingly claimed its belonging to the Palestinian nation, while they were more than ever intending to settle in their host countries. A clear sign of this paradox is the fact that a good part of this nationalist ethnic press was written in Spanish as Rumbos. The second generation born in Palestine was already losing its capacity, its ability to read and write and in Arabic. The cultural distance with the homeland was widening, and in Latin America, the immigrants were about to seize new economic opportunities. The last significant political battle of this period was the mobilization against the partition of Palestine, voted in the General Assembly of the UN in November 1947. The mobilization against this resolution in Latin America was in reality a last-minute campaign launched by Akram Zaiter, who came from Palestine to convince Latin American leaders not to vote the partition. And in fact, it had some results. Thanks to the strong mobilization of Palestinian communities, Chile and Honduras decided at the very last moment to abstain this UN resolution. But this was in vain, as we know, since the resolution was adopted. And the following decades were marked by the deepening of cultural assimilation. In 1970, exogamous marriages, that is, marriages between Arabs and non-Arabs, had become the norm. According to a recent investigation today in Chile, only around 30% of Palestinian descendants have both parents of Palestinian origin. The new generations whose fathers were immigrants became Chileans, Hondurans, Peruvians, in a nutshell, Latin Americans of Palestinian descent. Not even Palestinian Chileans, like one can be Arab American. Hyphenated identities don't exist in Latin America. In multiracial and multi-ethnic Latin American societies, national identification comes first. However, it does not mean that identification with Palestine was lost. Palestinian identity survived through ethnic networks of friends, families, and business partners, through social clubs like the Estadio Palestino, the Club Palestino in Santiago, or the Club Hondureño Árabe in San Pedro Sula, and also through cultural practices like food, a vector maybe less powerful than language and religion, but that produced embodied and affective feelings of connection with Palestine. Every Latin American of Palestinian descent will always start speaking about its Palestinian identity with souvenirs of lunches at the grandparents' place eating makluba, stuffed marrows, and eggplants. These elements of cultural identity were not necessarily visible in the public space, but they were very present in the private sphere. So during the 50s and 60s, the political dimension of Palestinian identity became clearly less relevant. But this changed again from the second half of the 70s and even more during the 80s. Unlike in other regions, it is not directly the Six-Day War of 1967 which really made a difference, but the recognition of the PLO in 1974 by the United Nations as the sole legitimate representative of the Palestinian people. Why? Because it allowed the PLO to open Palestine information offices all across the continent and to develop a network of representatives. the repoliticization of the diaspora was part of their mission. However, working or not with the PLO created tensions among the community. The tensions were such that some individuals even denounced their fellows from the Palestinian club to the Chilean political police, for example. Jael Alarja, a member of the PFLP who regularly came to Latin America since the beginning of the 1970s, was killed in 1976 during the Operation Entebbe against the hijacking of an Air France flight by PFLP members. You can imagine how terrified were the Palestinians in Chile who had known him. The PLO was seen as subversive. Aware of this obstacle, not only in Chile but in other Latin American countries, the PLO decided to send the father Ibrahim Ayad, a Catholic priest born in Betzahor and close to Yasser Arafat, to change the PLO's image among this predominantly Christian diaspora. The turning point was 1982 and the massacre of the Palestinian refugees in the camps of Sabra and Shatila in Lebanon. The killing of women, children, and the elderly provoked an emotion that went beyond political divisions. In Chile, it fostered the first demonstration of unity among Palestinians. In 1984, the Palestinian Club of Chile and the Federation of Brazilian Palestinian Associations called for the first Congress of Palestinian Entities from Latin America and the Caribbean. The Congress took place in São Paulo and resulted in the creation of the COPLAC, the Latin American Confederation of Palestinian Institutions. 11 representatives from Latin America were designated to be members of the Palestinian National Congress of the PLO. This new institutionalized connection with the PLO provided a big momentum, especially among the youth. Tens of groups of DAPKE were formed in Brazil, in Chile, and in other Latin American countries. Many belong to SANAUD, a transnational cultural movement created by the PLO for young people of Palestinian descent to reconnect with Palestinian culture. In Chile, university students were even beyond and founded the local branch of the General Union of Palestinian Students. Chile currently is the country where a core group of individuals of Palestinian origin is the best organized to defend the Palestinian cause. We are actually witnessing a process of professionalization of the pro-Palestinian movement since the beginning of the 2000s. Palestinian-Chilean politicians can be found now across the full political spectrum. From the right to the Communist Party, but they cooperate when it comes with Palestine. A Palestinian-Chilean interparliamentarian group was constituted and is today the most numerous among the binational groups of the Chilean Congress. In 2001, wealthy Chilean Palestinian businessmen created the Palestinian Bethlehem 2000 Foundation, a charity organization for Palestinian children that also does political lobbying and cultural work towards the community. The foundation publishes a monthly magazine called Al Damir, which aims at diffusing success stories of Palestinian Chileans, as well as briefing about the activities of the community and the humanitarian situation in Palestine. There is also a Palestinian-Chilean news agency, as well as two other websites that provide daily updates and op-eds regarding the situation in Palestine. These are the main sources of information for Palestinian Chileans, as well as other people who are interested in the situation in the Middle East. For concluding, again, political divisions and debates still exist within this diaspora organization, but it doesn't hamper their work and their impact. There is clearly today a growing interest among the youth about their Palestinian origin. Internet, social networks, and also the possibility to travel to Palestine have facilitated this reconnection. even very few still have close relatives here. The biggest problem today is probably the difficulties to enter Palestine, as Israeli authorities tend to discriminate visitors according to their ancestry. Over the last 5 years, 4 young Chilean women were deported from Tel Aviv or the Ayanbid Bridge because of their Palestinian surname.
Thank you very much for that really fascinating talk. At this point, I just want to remind those watching online that if you have questions for us, you can send them in at this point, and we'll take questions also from the floor. Just wait for the microphone to get to you. So we have questions here, right here. Just one moment.
This was a comprehensive explanation about the Latins Latin America, which I'm Ratib Ravi with the Holy Land Christian Ecumenical Foundation, and now we have presence in Chile, Guatemala, and Salvador, and Honduras. And the thing here, what you are saying, mostly correct, and mostly the people you are talking about, they are into that arena of politics or business, but the thing here is what we can do about it. And always we look at the diaspora as separate from the local people. We need your help in how we can implement this documentary, what you are writing, you know, I can put it this way, or this background, into action. Because now we have young people going there. We have the church of Honduras and Guatemala, and all of them, they are interested in the Palestinians. You need to empower the Palestinians in order to do something for Palestine, as mostly they recognize the Palestinian states now because of individuals. You mentioned their names while you are talking at this moment. Now, your thing, you are not of Palestinian origin. What made you interested in this topic, as this is most of the Palestinian, they didn't do that. You know, they just know they are there. Thank you.
Okay. I answered this question or right now? Okay. So I will begin with your last question, the personal one. I was telling earlier that I was born in France. I'm of Chilean origin. My father was himself a political exile. And as such, I was very politicized. And in France, the Palestinian issue, the Palestinian cause, is very strong among social movements, etc. So in 2002, during the Israeli invasion of the West Bank, I was myself participating in demonstration in Paris, and I heard on the radio that there was a gathering in front of the presidential palace in Santiago. And that's how I discovered that a big Palestinian diaspora existed in Chile. And I said, okay, this is for me. this will be my topic of research, because I think that I found some echo on the with the Palestinians in Chile, an echo of my own self-identification with Chile. It acted like a mirror, I would say, of my own experience. So that's the answer of the personal question. Now, what the Palestinians in Latin America can do for Palestine? That's your question. There are many dimensions, I think, in this question. First, politically, I think that right now they are doing their best. The recognition of the Palestinian state by almost all the Latin American states, and the development of new foreign policies toward the Palestinian-Israeli question, I think it's really a big step. We really see a change, and I think that they can't do more than that, because the other part is from Palestine itself. I think that there is like a political crisis in Palestine right now, and I think that Palestinians have to solve this issue, because from Latin America they will not be able to solve the problem in Palestine within the Palestinian leadership. I mean, so it's complicated. But I think that right now they are organized, they are present in the Congress. I mean, they are doing their best, and I think they are doing well. There are also many charity organizations. Most of them try to do something for their hometowns. I know that the University of Bethlehem, for example, received some funds from this diaspora in Latin America. The Palestine Bethlehem 2000 Foundation was created for the 2000 Jubilee in Bethlehem, and they helped to reconstruct, rebuild, and restore many monuments and historical buildings. So this is also what they can do, charity. Finally, I would say that the part of the reconnection has to do with the fact of promoting research on the Palestinians in Latin America. I'm not saying this for myself, but the fact that we know so little about them, I think this is a problem. And something has to change within Palestinian historiography to look at them, to know them much better than we know them, because sometimes they feel that they are a little bit abandoned, you know, by the rest of the Palestinians. So that's my answer.
Let's go right here in the back, and we'll work our way around. Just wait for the microphone, sir.
Well, thank you for your very interesting talk. I had a question about racialization, really. You brought up instances of discrimination briefly. Mm-hmm. Today, some scholars debate to what degree current Muslim immigrants are being racialized. But earlier, before the Second World War, I'm wondering to what degree racialization was an important aspect and how it played out differently in Latin America. For example, people from Palestine coming to Brazil, right, were faced with, Native Americans, India was there, and also people who were recently enslaved during the empire. And so they might have been more perceived as whitish immigrants, whereas Syrians or even southern Italians going to the southern U.S. in the same time period were at risk of lynching. And in the 1920s, legislation was passed that dramatically made it much more difficult to legally enter the country. So, you know, I was wondering to what degree the incorporation process in terms of racialization is really different in certain countries, and if that has anything to do with the fact that there's a larger concentration of Palestinians in Chile and in Honduras rather than any other countries.
As you said, racialization works very differently in Latin America than in particular in the US. So when they arrived, only a small intellectual elite really racialized them and identified them as a Semites. For the rest of the population, including the immigration officers, it was not clear at all. They had no idea from where they came from, and frankly, they saw them as white. After that, the fact that the states themselves didn't create racial categories, for example, in the census, made that race didn't work really at an administrative or even a political category. In fact, this is the contrary. This is a problem. It was a problem for the indigenous people. They had to create, during the 90s, new categories to make visible this population who were made invisible during many, many decades, because the national myth of almost all Latin American countries where they were mixed raced. So as mixed raced population, no race was pointed out in particular. On the contrary, you had to be part of the nation. You have to be, in a way, to show that you were mixed raced. So there was not a process of racialization, except from these intellectuals until the 30s. And right now, as ethnic politics is much more something of the indigenous and the black populations, the descendants of immigrants, not only the Palestinians, but also Jewish or others, they don't want to use ethnic politics because it's like, it's stigmatized a little bit people from, like, you're from another social class. You know, when you are from the middle and upper class, you don't use ethnic politics. It's not really prestigious to use ethnic politics. Nobody talk about ethnic lobbies or things like that. You are, first of all, you are a national of your country. You are a Chilean first, you are a Mexican first, you are a Peruvian first, and then there are invisible networks. Of course, they exist, but you never use it in the public space because of the class position. And because ethnicity is something only for indigenous and black people. Because ethnic politics it's a political game you use for obtaining some new rights. And as the Palestinian descendants are already first-class citizens, they don't need, new rights, new position in universities. They don't need new tools for compensating their social situation. They already are first-class citizens. They don't need it. And on the contrary, it's more stigmatized to use this kind of vocabulary, of lexicon, of ethnicity than something praised.
Thank you so much for the talk, and thank you again to the Palestinian Center for a wonderful event. You are studying now the changing foreign policies by certain Latin American countries. I know that it's this the new socialistic countries like Venezuela, Ecuador, Bolivia, and always Cuba, who have expressed already a very clear opposition to the Israeli policies and in favor of the Palestinians. Can you mention a couple of examples of these policies by these countries, Bolivia, Ecuador, Venezuela, and Cuba?
Yeah. Well, I didn't mention it during the talk because it was already too long, but during the 70s, when the PLO entered in Latin America, it made strong contacts with the leftist guerrillas. So from the beginning of the 80s, the end of the 70s and the beginning of the 80s, the PLO had contact in Nicaragua with the Sandinists, of course with Cuba, but also with the Workers' Party in Brazil, with the MIR in Chile, which was the opposition to the dictatorship, the communist opposition to the dictatorship. So when these guerrilla went through an evolution and became institutionalized leftist parties, like the worker parties in Brazil, these leaders from the left already had contact and already knew the Palestinian cause from this period. So they already had this special sensibility to the Palestinian issue. And it's true that from the 2000, we really are witnessing a strong political change towards the Palestinian-Israeli issue, because before that, Latin America was more considered as friendly to Israel. Also because it received development aid from Israel, and all the dictatorship had a military connection also. The Israel sold weapons to almost all the military dictatorships. So from the 2000, this changed. How? First, Chile and Brazil were the first in establishing a diplomatic office in Ramallah. So there were those who started the relation. It was not the PLO or even the Palestinian Authority who came first to Latin America. It was first Latin American leaders who were interested in Palestine. Brazil now is an important donor. It's even one of the most important donor of the UNRWA, the UN relief agency for the refugees, especially at a moment when everybody is not giving money anymore. Brazil is putting some funds in these agencies, so it's important. And on the diplomatic side, the countries of ALBA, which are Venezuela, Bolivia, Ecuador, and Nicaragua. Well, Venezuela suspended its diplomatic relation with Israel after the Gaza war at the beginning of 2009. It was followed by Bolivia, who did the same. And a year after, Nicaragua also suspended its relation with Israel, but it was after the attack against the humanitarian flotilla for Gaza. So these three countries right now don't have any diplomatic relations with Israel. The others, Brazil, Argentina, Chile, still have relations with Israel, mainly economic. The Mercosur, which is the custom union of Brazil, Argentina, Uruguay, Paraguay, and Venezuela, has a free trade agreement with Israel. But it also has one with Palestine, which is more symbolic than something else. But to show that they have a balanced view, and above all that they want to distance themselves from the U.S. foreign policy, to show their autonomy and saying that so far the U.S. Have not been a honest broker, and that Latin America can develop a different stance, having a balanced position. And in this case, balanced position is being a little bit more in favor of the Palestinians, who were completely abandoned by the rest of the Western countries.
Since we are running over on time, what I want to do is, and I want to try to get everyone's questions, if you could give us your questions all together, and then we'll try to get a response. We'll start here. Sure, one of you two could start, but let's get everyone in, and then we'll get a response together.
Okay. Thank you for a great talk. I had the opportunity to become aware of the Lebanese diaspora in South America when I lived there, and actually saw evidence of the phalangist politicians in Lebanon trying to gain support for their role in the or for their ideologies during the Lebanese Civil War. I'm very curious to know, since I know the term Turco has been used for both Lebanese and Palestinians and Syrians, if you could comment on the relationships between these closely related diaspora communities. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Asantua Nkrumah Ture. I'm a member of a church called Plymouth Congregational United Church of Christ here in Washington, D.C. You touched on part of my question. With our conference, we want to have a panel on Israel's support for repressive regimes in Latin America. Mm-hmm. So if you have any more information about that, that would be helpful for us. And also, if you have any information about the impact on Palestinians in Chile of the murder of Allende. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bortaji. 2 points. Your use of the term racialization, that's a tricky term in English, and if you could use a different term such as ethnic identification and so on, be better, because racialization suggests racism. Number two, the Arab population in Latin America is much more than just the Palestinian population, of course, which, and the Arab population probably numbers over 10 million, perhaps closer to 20. What kind of cooperation is there between those groups and the Palestinians. I'm thinking about the fact that the former president of Argentina, Carlos Menem, Syrian background, billionaire in Mexico, Carlos Slim, and so on.
Thank you for your talk. I was wondering about the role of the church in some of those politics. So there was a Father Ibrahim Ayad that was pictured there with Abu Yad. Sorry about the same name there. But I was wondering if you could talk, because usually people think of churches in Latin America as being on the right. Was there a difference because they were Orthodox or had this very strong ethnic identification with being Palestinian? And I was wondering if there were transnational relations between the churches in Chile and the Antiochian church that was based in Damascus. Thank you.
Thank you for the information on Chile. I very much enjoyed the insight on the Ande period. How much is a factor of tensions between Christian and Muslim Muslims in Palestine and the waves of immigration coming to South America?
Okay, so I will not answer all the questions. Maybe after we can.
You can take all the time.
Exactly. How the Lebanese, the Syrian, and the Palestinians cooperate? They were all called Turcos. In fact, they are. Besides the Palestinian organization association or the Lebanese or the Syrian, there are also many Arab associations. So I would say that it is rather fluid the way they participate in one or in another. For example, in the cities where Palestinians are not enough or Lebanese are not enough to have their own organization, they have a common association, and it's not a problem at all. I mean, they all consider they are Arabs and they are paisanos, how they say that, part of the same region of origin. And even if right now we could, for example, with the Syrian war, right now is causing much trouble among the Arab organizations because maybe this issue is even more controversial than the Palestinian one. The Palestinian one is more a factor of unity than of divisions. On the contrary, the Syrian war currently is really an issue that is provoking divides. So as much as I have seen, again, these three communities really go well together, and especially the Palestinian is a factor of unity. Allende was not murdered. He committed the suicide. It was proved very recently because there was a myth, a debate around his death, whether he was killed or he committed suicide. He committed suicide, and the Palestinians has nothing to do with this. I mean, the relation of Israel with the military dictatorship. This began after the Carter administration. Until the Carter administration, the U.S. were the main provider of arms for Latin America and for the Latin American dictatorship. But with Carter, this stopped, and Latin American dictators had to find another source. That's how emerged the Israeli solution for the dictatorships. And actually, it's quite strange. For example, if we take the Pinochet regime, the first years until 1979, he was rather pro-Palestinian. And between 1975 in particular and 1979, there were many declarations where he clearly supported the inalienable rights of the Palestinian people. And this was after the oil crisis. Brazil and Chile both tried to strengthen their relations with the Arab oil producers, and they did so by making this declaration, this pro-Palestinian declaration. And Brazil went quite far. It voted, for example, in 1975, the resolution saying that Zionism is a form of racism. And it was the dictatorship in Brazil. So there is also this part of the story where the dictatorship in Latin America at the beginning had a rather pro-Arab stance, but it changed at the end of the 70s and above all at the beginning of the 80s. I know that some Palestinians in Chile wanted absolutely that Arafat could meet Pinochet, But Arafat always said no. He smartly understood that it was a very bad idea, and it didn't happen. But I know that some Palestinians in Chile were very eager to make this happen. About the church. If it's true that the majority of the immigrants were Orthodox, during the years of cultural assimilation, the decades of cultural assimilation, which I identified as the 50s and from 50s, 60s, most of them, it's not that they converted to Catholicism, but there were not many Orthodox churches, and it was easier for them to send their children to Catholic schools, and etc. So now, right now, the majority of them are just Catholics. They are not Orthodox anymore. There is a tiny minority which is still Orthodox, and of course there is a strong link between the fact of being Orthodox and being very nationalist, I mean very pro-Palestinian. There is they always make this strong linkage, but they are a minority. They are a minority. And the Orthodox Church, yes, it's part of the network of the Antiochian Church, yeah. Not Greek, no. And your last question, if Christian immigration favored some conflict, religious conflict in Palestine, for sure. For sure in Bethlehem there is, it's complicated because the question is if immigrants start selling their properties, their houses, and it's not only to the Jewish people who want to buy land. It happened during all the from the 40s and the 50s, 60s. It was always an issue, but it's also the Muslims. In Bethlehem, the presence, the prominence of the Muslims in Bethlehem, yes, it's a little bit complicated, and it's true that immigration favored this feeling, something that is sometimes quite paranoia, I would say, from the Christian side. But I heard in Bethlehem some bad things about this, and they feel that they are disappearing from Palestine, and yes, they have this feeling that they have to protect their community against the Muslims, and immigration participated in that.
Thank you very much, and thank you to our audience as well.